all the legal luminaries in Tamil Nadu, on behalf of our Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, we wholeheartedly welcome Dr. Ambrose, David Ambrose. We welcome you, sir. My dear friend, Dr. Balaji, the present director of UGNPG of Tamil Nadu, Dr. Ambedkar Law University School of Excellence in Law. He held various positions in our university, doing wonderful service for the cause and welfare of our Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University. He will head one of the panels of today's workshop. On behalf of our college, we wholeheartedly welcome Dr. Balaji sir. Welcome you, sir. My younger brother, Dr. Amirdalingam, who is well known to me for many more years. In fact, he was part of our Law University some time back, and he got appointment in Trichy National Law School, now Tamil Nadu National Law University. He is holding important position in Tamil Nadu National Law University also. He is in charge of examinations also. So in this wonderful occasion, I am very happy to welcome my younger brother, Dr. Amirdalingam. Welcome, Amirdalingam.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you, Director.
One of our very known academician, doing wonderful service in our Department of Legal Studies, our alma mater, Dr. Rajesh Sagar. He will deliver his address as a part of this workshop on behalf of our Government Law College, Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College. We welcome Dr. Rajesh Sagar. We welcome you, sir. On behalf of our 129-year-old Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College, we welcome the principals of Government Law Colleges who joined today. Due to time constraint, I welcome all the principals wholeheartedly. Once again, I welcome all the principals of our Government Law Colleges all over Tamil Nadu. We welcome you, madam. Welcome you, sirs. Most of our college lecturers have joined this workshop on behalf of Chennai Dr. Ambedkar Government Law College. I wholeheartedly welcome all the faculty members of our Government Law Colleges and also institutions imparting legal education all over India. I welcome all the academicians, guest lecturers, advocates, and last but not least, on behalf of the Government Law College, we welcome all our beloved law students throughout India. Once again, I welcome you all and seek your full support and cooperation for the successful conduct of this workshop. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you to our beloved principal. We are greatly honored to have been guided under the captain of our ship, Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. N.S. Santosh Kumar sir, who strives for the welfare of achieving the standard of government law colleges in Tamil Nadu. For any development for legal education, the approval would always be positive since it is headed by our beloved professor. The standard of Government Law College is equally appreciated because of the constant effort put to keep it in par with the evolving legal education system. The achievements of our beloved sir is far more than it can be said here. Professor Dr. Santosh Kumar, the Director of Legal Studies, is the reason behind the number of Government Law Colleges in Tamil Nadu. There were initially 7 traditional law colleges, and the effort of our sir raised the number of law colleges to 14, which is quite high in number. During his regime, he appointed 186 professors and faculties, the highest in the history of legal education. His constant effort has brought 5 new PG degrees in almost 6 colleges. We now call upon our beloved professor to share a few words.
Thank you. Thank you. Good afternoon, one and all. I'm extremely happy to have all of you in this virtual workshop, which is being conducted in commemoration of United Nations Platinum Jubilee celebrations. At the outset, on behalf of Directorate of Legal Studies, I appreciate Dr. Chokkalingam and his colleagues, Dr. Balaji, and each and every lecturers of that college for arranging this program in a very coveted way. It is my pride to welcome, on behalf of the Directorate of Legal Studies, Chennai, a legal luminary and the custodian of the international law of this country, Dr. Koteshwar Rao, the Secretary General, Indian Society of International Law. Personally speaking, when I was doing my LLM at Cochin University 34 years back, he paid a visit to Cochin University department and spoke with us in such a way that one can do good in legal education only when he should know about the legal development which takes place all around the world. That day he told, now he proves and makes all of us to realize also. Let me wholeheartedly welcome that living Hugo Grotius and thank him for accepting our invitation and being with us online. I'm extremely happy to note that Professor Dr. Gandhi, Dean of VIT School of Law, Chennai, is also with us, who always inspire all of us through his thought-provoking speech and lectures. He is making a silent revolution through an institution in this society. Thank you, sir, for accepting our invitation and coming over online. Dr. David Ambrose, who always associate with us in all our endeavors, especially in any law college matters, let it be academic or administrative. His total involvement, one can witness everywhere. Thank you, sir, for being with us in this afternoon. Our good friends, Dr. Balaji, HOD of Tamil Nadu, Dr. Ambedkar Law University, Dr. Amrithalingam, Associate Professor, National Law University, Trichy, and Dr. Rajasekhar, Associate Professor, University of Madras, are also with us. Their presence makes all of us delighted in this workshop-based celebration. It is for my pleasure to welcome all of them on behalf of the department. In addition to that, my beloved principals from various law colleges are also participating. I'm welcoming each and everyone for this workshop. Ladies and gentlemen, as we all know that with very good objects, United Nations was established. As we all know that since its foundation in the year, during the year 1945, and at present with 193 countries, it was conceived as an instrument to face the most relevant global challenges emerging in the international system. No doubt, this intergovernmental institutions heavily contribute to the formation of international peace, stability, and cooperation. Though United Nations maintain peace and security, or prevent nuclear proliferation, or support of disarmament, or preventing genocide, or contributing effectively for the economic development, are taking part in alleviating poverty, are promoting for women well-being, are fighting against hunger, are active participation in social development, are protecting human rights, are working for preventing the climate change, are protecting even the ozone layer, are combating the international crimes, are maintaining international justice, are involving in humanitarian affairs, are concentrating on health affairs, we do agree. But see the effect of United Nations as on date. All the activities of the United Nations, more or less I report here, but see the its effect. Dr. Kofi Annan, the then Secretary General of United Nations, acknowledged as we have come across to in a fork in the road. This may be a moment no less decisive than 1945 itself, when the United Nations was founded. I believe the time is ripened for the hard look at the fundamental policy issues and the structural changes that may be needed in order to strengthen them. The radical reform of the United Nations established a high-level threat changes and some sort of challenges. So from these words, one can easily come to a conclusion that the Secretary General himself was not satisfied with the performance of United Nations due to so many reasons. He has expressed a certain extent directly and certain extent indirectly also the present situation of United Nations. So where the United Nations stand as on date? What extent UN has achieved the object for which it was created? What extent it won in its endeavors? What extent it could get success in its mission? What prevents these institutions to work freely? What dominates these institutions? What are the impediments it faces in the international sphere? I am leaving it to the participants who discuss in detail about all these things. When it celebrates its 75th year, one should think of the challenges before these institutions also. The world community don't see it as an immediate, its immediate relevance itself, since it faces failure in all fields. Nationalism and populism are becoming more popular now. Multilateralism has become out of fashion. So the new contemporary global changes are jeopardizing the solidity and effectiveness. Perpetual power struggle between states push back the states. Failure of ensuring the collective security between the states itself is questioned. The attitude of the permanent members of the superpowers towards these institutions, especially the approach of US, Russia, and China. The contemporary global challenges, like spread of security threats, which leads to traditional terrorism and illicit arms trade. Struggling in preventing conflicts between nations, and there is no supranational authority that wields the overwhelming powers. The failure to create an UN common international army due to the reluctance of the members state. So, lack of democratic mechanisms and its accountability affects its structure and composition of the Security Council, which still reflects on the power distribution. The five permanent members, United Nations, France, United Kingdom, China, and Russia, hold more powers and prerogative before the constructive participation of the non-permanent members. The absence of power mechanism to empower the judgments of the International Court of Justice. When the International Court of Justice was created, it was agreed that states had to accept the court's jurisdiction in order to allow it to judge the controversies. But what is the position now? Take the case of Jagadev. So things are moving on in this way. The global bodies such as United Nations are normally used by the powerful nation to exert their well-being. The failure to prevent the genocide could be seen as an example of superpowers having little interest in the region. it is evident that United Nations is inactive and realist view that it cannot transcend the power struggle between the state. United Nations record of standing with the dictators, condemning human rights violations and preventing genocides are very poor. This demonstrates the lack of moral compass within US. UN compelling us to think that it is an outmoral institution or ineffective organization. That is the present situation. Hence, ladies and gentlemen, you find out where UN is as on date. Any possibility to witness a change in its behavior in the near future? Any possibility to have any change in the attitude of the superpower? If it continues like that, where it will end? Is any possibility to address the existing challenges? If no signs, how to ensure the international peace? How to protect the human rights? How to combat the terrorism? How to control the international smuggling? How to stop the international drug trade? How to get international justice and implement it? How to stop to see piracy? How to modify the existing structure of the international bodies? How to make this superpower a committed member of United Nations? How to make the superpower well under the international laws? How to overcome the constitutional setback of these international institutions? These are all the matters where the participants should concentrate and come to a conclusion. With these few words, I wish the forum to analyze these issues in detail and come out with the constructive ideas, put it in writing and send a copy to the Ministry of External Affairs or any other relevant forums for their future references. Then alone, workshop like this will get the real success. All the best. Almighty bless you all with good health. And I appeal to each and everyone to take care of your health. Thank you. Thank you so much for inviting me in this webinar. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We are happy to start the event for the day by inviting Mr. M. Koteshwara Rao, sir, legal consultant at Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India, with 26 years of experience in international law, trade and investment law, who referred India as the legal advisor to the World Trade Organization. He is currently the Secretary General of Indian Society of International Law based in New Delhi. He has an experience of negotiating investment treaties and trade agreement of India with countries like Canada, Japan and other countries. He has chaired and participated in session of UN Compensation Commission, UNICITRAL, etc. He has also prepared and drafted WTO dispute settlement amended proposals and has appeared before WTO dispute settlement panels, an appellate body on anti-dumping. Welcome you, sir.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen.
Sir,
can you please hear me?
Sir,
can you hear me, please?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Please.
Good afternoon. You are audible.
You're audible.
Okay. Thank you very much. Ellarku vanakkam from Delhi. I'm very grateful to Professor Chokalingam, principal of the college, for inviting me to this function. And I am also very thankful to Professor Santosh Kumar, Director Legal Studies, for his kind words. And also, I feel that he set the tone for the debate, for the discussion today. Rightly said a few words, Ruchi, about the power structure, nationalism, rising nationalism, and of course genocide, etc. I mentioned. And also, I recognize my senior colleague, Professor Dr. M. Gandhi, Dean, VIT College, VIT University. Professor Dr. David Ambrose, he was the head of the department of my alma mater, Department of Legal Studies in Madras University. And Professor Dr. Balaji, Dr. Amrutalingam, Dr. G. Rajashekar, Dr. C. Anita Fabiola, and Ms. Saranya. Thank you all. Thank you for inviting me. As I said, Professor Santosh Kumar has set the tone, and he rightly mentioned a few things, which I will take it forward. If we see the establishment of United Nations, it is not out of vacuum. It is soon after the Second World War, the United Nations was established. It was established when there was so much of destruction and millions of people died. More than 50 million, I think about 4-5 crores of people died, 5 to 7 crores of people died in the war, either directly or indirectly. And immediately preceding that, or during that time, 6 million Jews, more than 6 million Jews were massacred and gas put into the gas chambers and killed by, as you all know. And before that, we had the League of Nations. That was about 20 years before. We had a First World War. League of Nations was established. But League of Nations, somebody said, the interim period, the interregnum period between the First World War and Second World War, is it a peacetime? Somebody said, no. Actually, they are preparing for the Second World War. That was a time they were preparing for the Second World War. And the establishment of United Nations was, as rightly said by the present president of the 75th session of the United Nations, His Excellency Volkan Bozkurt, on 21st September this year, he said, 75 years ago, the United Nations was established in the smoldering wreckage of the war, World War II, and deadliest history demonstrated clearly. So this is how that is the history of the Second World War, and the soon after the establishment of United Nations. Then, as the title of this the seminar says, what are its successes? What are its challenges? The success is, as rightly said by the Secretary General Antonio Guterres on 21st September, he said, the success of the United Nations so far is a third world war has been avoided. I quote, a third world which so many had feared has been avoided. Never in modern history have we gone so many years without a military confrontation between the major powers. And he says that this is not a small achievement. This is a great achievement of which member states can be proud and which we all must strive to preserve. So, major war has been avoided between the major powers on the scale of Second World War or First World War. Then many people may be thinking that what about the ongoing small wars like Nagorno-Karabakh between Armenia and Azerbaijan, Syria, and the constant struggle, conflict between Israel and Palestinians. There are many, many mini struggles, many wars going on. What is the United Nations is doing? Ever since it's established, even between India and Pakistan, there were 3 wars happened. One may say, while on one hand we can be satisfied that there was no major war between the powers, on the other hand, the objective and purpose is to prevent the wars and also to maintain international peace and security. As Director of Legal Studies said, there was no consensus among the major powers to have a unified military unit under the command of the United Nations. There was no agreement. That's why you don't have an international military power where UN can command and can effectively prevent the war. Soon after the Second World War, soon after the establishment of the United Nations, we have seen the Korean War. Then it has evolved, a procedure was evolved whereby the United Nations, since it doesn't have military power, it has authorized the powers, five powers, whichever is capable, to take action. So that's why there was in the Korean War, the powers, US, United States and its allies, they could effectively intervene and prevent the war. So by and large, I would say the establishment of United Nations, I would totally agree with Secretary General Antonio Guterres, that major achievement is peace for such a long time, 75 years, has prevailed. Though there are so many wars, which still United Nations can still do it, still capable of doing it. But the only thing is, United Nations being an intergovernmental body, it can do what its membership can authorize it to do. So if membership is not willing to contribute, membership is not willing to allow United Nations to do what as per the mandate, it will not be able to move. The another great success, the greatest success of the United Nations is decolonization. As you all know, India is one of the founding members. At the time of establishment of United Nations, 51 states were the parties to founding members of the United Nations, including India, including Belarus, including Ukraine. But are we republic that time? Are we sovereign government, independent government? No, it was a British Indian membership. But yet we can rightly claim that we are the founding members. India is our founding members. And subsequently, the United Nations Secretariat, the legal department, felt that it was Pakistan which has to seek the new membership. So at the time of Second World War, establishment of United Nations, more than 750 million people were under colonial rule. Now there are only small number of people who are under colonial rule. That's the 2 million people. What a vast difference. And at the time of establishment of United Nations, 51 were the founding members. Now the United Nations membership has gone up to 193 members. And as you know, the colonialism, of course, India has been in forefront, non-aligned movement was in forefront. In Africa, there used to be only four countries which are members of United Nations earlier: Egypt, Ethiopia, Liberia, and South Africa. Now there are 55 members. So that is the power of the colonialism, the decolonization. Now we are at the last year of the third decade of the decolonization. The United Nations declared this is the third decade of the last year, 2001 to 2020. That was at 2011 to 2020. Now, I mentioned this decolonization. The reason is, you all know what happened in the case of the Chagos Islands. Chagos Islands, last year, the International Court of Justice Sorry for the disruption. So I quickly round up. Now, as you all know, the Mauritius at the time of independence, United Kingdom at the time of giving independence to the Mauritius in 1968, it took away, there are Chagos Islands, number of islands were taken away from it, separated from it, and gave the freedom to independence to Mauritius. And also there are three islands which were separated from Seychelles, and Seychelles was given independence. These are the two island nations in Indian Ocean. They are part of Africa. Though the United Kingdom chose to give it back, the three islands, to the Seychelles, but it retained Chagos Islands with it, and and it leased for 30 years to the United States for establishment of military base in the Diego Garcia. Is one of the major main big islands in the Chagos Island. Chagos Island. So the Mauritius has been keep raising this issue in African forum, in all international forums, including United Nations. Finally, with the support of the developing countries, African countries and developing countries, including India, they approached the United Nations General Assembly. The United Nations General Assembly in June 2017, it adopted a resolution seeking the advisory opinion of International Court of Justice. February last year, the International Court of Justice had given an opinion saying that territorial integrity is a part of customary international by dividing the country, territory of the country, the United Kingdom, the independence was not complete. The colonization of the Mauritius, decolonization of the Mauritius was not complete. Therefore, continuous occupation of the United Kingdom of the Chagos Islands, which is part and parcel of Mauritius, is violation of international law. And subsequently, the matter went back to the General Assembly. General Assembly has given 6 months' time for the United Kingdom to vacate those islands and hand over those islands to the United Kingdom. Hand over those islands to the Mauritius. But United Kingdom failed it. It was only United Kingdom and United States of America. These are the only two countries which voted against the resolution. And still, United Kingdom is in violation of international law with respect to the Mauritius and Chagos Islands. So, as Director of Legal Studies pointed out, major powers are not abide by the international law. When United States of America walked out of the Nicaragua case and did not respect the ICJ, Internal Court of Justice judgment, there was a criticism. And subsequently, now China has done the same thing. China did not respect the arbitral tribunal award in the South China Sea when Philippines has taken it up at the international under the Law of the Sea Convention. So major powers are able to get away with violation of law. This is how I think the Director of Legal Studies also briefly mentioned about it. So these are some of the failures, how to make the major powers abide by the law is one of the major challenges of United Nations before it, because they are the permanent powers, they have veto power, and no one can do anything. Quickly, a few other, as I think Professor Santosh Kumar has mentioned also, the structure. Yes, way back in 1945, 75 years ago, power structure is different. That time, France was made to be part of permanent member. Even though France was defeated, France was bombarded by the Germany, and it was United Kingdom which went to its rescue. Now there are five members. The power structure has changed. United Kingdom after Brexit, it is not going to be as big as power as it is. Even Scotland may seek for independence, though it's not a part of colonialism, but it may went away. If that is the case, United Kingdom is like any other country. It's like any other country which is not a superpower, which of course it ceases to be a superpower. So there remains only two superpowers. I mean, United States of America, which remains a superpower, and China is rising power, and then India. So what about India? Does it have any chance of sitting at the high table as a permanent member? That is one. So when the power structure changes, world has changed in 75 years, so also the United States structure also has to be changed. But are they going to agree? A power like United Kingdom or France ready to accommodate, ready to give up their seats? I doubt very much. Similarly, Africa with 54 countries, it doesn't have any seat. Should they not be accommodated? These are all the questions. Another major important, that's the challenge for future. I will conclude with this. More than 20 years ago, two decades ago, India has proposed comprehensive convention on terrorism. It has been being debated every year and nothing else is moving. Initially, we thought it's the Islamic countries which are obstructing it. That is true, but still they have a problem about adopting the Comprehensive Convention on International Terrorism. Pakistan has a problem. They think that Kashmir is a liberation movement. Similarly, Palestine is a liberation movement, which they are not agreeing. But in addition to that, when we dig deep into the dynamics, one of the major powers, United States of America, is not interested to have the CCIT. I'm saying with the reason is, they want exemption for their own soldiers. Wherever they are, they can commit atrocities. Look at the audacity with which United States of America withdrew the facilities, the visas of the International Criminal Court. They want exemption for their soldiers. International Criminal Court, they used to cooperate, though they were not members. They were not party to the International Criminal Court. So these are the challenges which we are going to put. As Director of Legal Studies mentioned, nationalism is on rising. And if, again, Trump is going to be elected, even if Trump is defeated, the policy will not be immediately changed. And China is another power which is trying to asserting more and more. So these are the challenges which are before the United States of United Nations, and let's all hope that it will be able to do good for the country, for the world, and it will survive. Thank you very much. Thank you. Vanakkam.
Thank you, Koteshwar Rao sir, for sharing with us the history of UN, the current existing Cold War portion of UN, and the existing challenges of UN with us. Thank you once again, sir. We are honored and privileged to have Dr. M. Gandhi sir, who is currently the Dean at VIT School of Law, Chennai campus. He was a professor and executive director for International Legal Studies at Jinnah Global Law School. Served as Joint Secretary and Legal Advisor in the Ministry of External Affairs, Government of India, with PhD in International and Constitutional Law from University of Madras. He is also a honorable recipient of L.C. Miller Gold Medal for Best Performer in ML Degree and various other prestigious awards. He has also represented India in ancestral working groups, including arbitration working groups. Having taught international law, constitutional law, and jurisprudence for around 17 years in the Indian universities, we are honored and keen to learn from him for the next few minutes. may we call upon our respected Dr. Gandhi sir to share some of his knowledge with us.
Good afternoon to everyone. Thank you very much for giving me an opportunity. It is really a privilege to talk to the teachers of law and the students of law. And I have in place my PowerPoint presentation. Now we know about the political structure of international law, an international organization like UN, and what are all the failures and what are all the success. And many of them, they have not mentioned about the success story, because the success story is normally, when you just look into critically, it'll not that easy to find out, because you know you have more often in a story, the one is the hero, the second is villain. Now people are talking a lot of about only the US, UK combination, Sagos Archipelago, like that. So they are get attracted by villains. But there has been some silent revolution that has taken place post UN, and especially in the field of international law. Now, so my talk today will be on UN and international law, success and failures in the making and upholding international law. And we have about 75% success and 25% failure. And the success and failures are, you know, the coming speakers also going to talk about that. Because when I say that it is a success story as far as the international law is concerned, and I would perhaps pin my hope on the success story like, first, law of the sea, second, human rights, and thirdly, it is partially success and partially, you know, it's a story, started story that is about international environmental law. So, you know, all the, then I would say, so all these components are going to be discussed in this, you know, webinar. So that is interesting. And my you know, presentation could be a kind of a prelude, and it could be taken as if, you know, what are all really the problems there. Now, Balaji, second slide. See, you can see that the United Nations was created, I have mentioned here, to save succeeding generations from the scourge of war. This is success. That's what Mr. Koteshwara was telling, and this is what you know, Director of Legal Studies was telling. That is what the people are telling. But at the same time, and there are about hundreds of small wars have been fought. And that is a different story, but you did not have a very big wars around. Right now, if I have, you know, in front of me, a global conflict tracker, every minute like COVID tracker, you can track if you have a cell phone attached to that. Now it shows that war in Afghanistan, territorial disputes in South China Sea, tension in East China Sea, North Korea crisis, confrontation between United States and Iran, civil war in Syria, political instability in Iraq, Islamist militancy in Pakistan, political instability in Lebanon, instability in Egypt, conflict in Ukraine, conflict between Turkey and armed Kurdish groups, criminal violence in Mexico, Israeli-Palestinian conflict, Boko Haram in Nigeria, conflict between India and Pakistan, instability in Venezuela. It goes on, like civil war in Libya, war in Yemen, Nagorno-Karabakh, you know, conflict, destabilization of Mali, violence in the Central African Republic again. So the small wars, and you know, it is stated that to save succeeding generation from the scourge of war. So they, now the small wars are, you know, dubbed as only conflicts. They will not come under the accounts. Okay. Then second important thing for which it has been created is protect human rights. I think, you know, they are successful. You cannot think of human rights in the pre-United Nations setup in an international organization. And third is to maintain international peace and security. And it is a dismal performance in the sense that whenever, you know, this the Europe is involved in that, they wanted to see some kind of a peace, you know, that should prevail. That is what happened, the NATO operation in Serbia. But all rest of the world is concerned, they are not concerned about that, whatever happens. And third, this is an important area for us, uphold international law. And how they are upholding international law, that part, you know, now we are looking into. In the upholding international law part, you know, there's Mr. Koteshwara was referring about the decolonization process, and especially in the decolonization process, how the territorial integrity should not be, you know, disrupted, like what Britain did. But it is not the first time that Britain did that. Britain did, you know, they break the whole Indian subcontinent into two and three and just share it between. The same way they did it, and they said that I retain something which is interesting for me, and the rest I will just give it to you. But the law is that, you know, when you are decolonized, and you have to free the other end also. But there is a tricky thing there, you know, where UK never said that it will not be given to them. It will be given to them at the time, place, and the manner they wanted it. That is what the document says. So simply they say that, you know, I did not say that, you know, it will not be given to them. So even in the violation, there could be a kind of a justification that they are within the law. Next slide. So in its 75th year today, we see that UN is in a difficult moment as the world faces climate crisis, global pandemic, great power competition, trade wars, economic depression, and wider breakdown international cooperation. So the result, you know, we are only one on webinar because, you know, we cannot even go to the physical facilities where we will be able to deliver lectures. So the idea is the 75th year is a bleak. It is a bleak, the 75th year. The reason is that climate crisis, because, you know, nobody, you know, wants to address that. And those countries which are all, you know, small island countries, for them it is a life and death. But whenever they come and approach the big powers say that, you know, one where it is lost is one where it is going to be gained. If it is your ice melted and you are no longer there, and we have land here. So what's the problem? So this is the indirectly equation that they have been pinning hopes on. So there is a climate crisis, global pandemic, and it is the institution which is supposed to address when this kind of a security issue is coming there, because it is a threat to peace and security. And they could do that when Ebola hits the COVID first kit, the resolution was there, and they could not do anything because international cooperation is completely on the very, very lower side today. After all the grand edifices they have constructed in the United Nations and even the international law, that should work only on the basis of international cooperation. Because the salient aspect of almost all the law that we have, either the hard or the soft international law, it's all work on the basis of duty to cooperate. That's all. When the other side is not cooperating, that's the end of the matter. That ends the matter. So the great power competition, trade wars, economic depression, and you know, before even the onset of COVID, it started. Now it is deepened. And wider breakdown of international cooperation, that is very much clear, because everybody works on self-interest. And the states which are supposed to just give statement, and these people are just, you know, coming as leaders, they don't care much about even their own country. Okay? So this is what. So this is not a right time to discuss about the existence of the UN, as well as the UN is really a misplaced emphasis in history, or it is different. Then you have to look into that. But at the same time, one important thing, if without UN, what happened? If you want to just think about the positively, you have to see without UN, what would have happened in these sectors where, you know, we got a progress today. So most significant contribution in the UN contribution is on human development. because you know the UN has made impressive and unprecedented progress in all aspects of human development, bringing great benefits to millions of people around the world. Even this Guterres, and he made it, what is the single contribution that is made by UN? He said that the single contribution, successful contribution made by UN is that it is that inoculating the entire population of the world. That is the biggest thing, because if he say that, so for the welfare dynamics of the world is concerned, maybe that UN has done something very good. And we will see now only the law, the development of law, international law, and what was the contribution. And let us take first the hard law. Next slide. The UN defined, codified, and expanded the realm of international law, governing the legal responsibility of states in their conduct with each other and their treatment of individuals within state boundaries. We will see today that more than 560 multilateral treaties on human rights, refugees, disarmament, trade, oceans, outer space, all encompassing all aspects of international affairs, were negotiated by the UN. If the UN is not there, you cannot have any multilateral forum where you will be able to negotiate the kind of a universal treaties. And you have to just end up negotiating a great number of bilateral treaties, which may not have any significance first. So, it offers a forum that you can negotiate if any law, new law you needed, and the new law can always, you can make it. So that is a possibility, and UN made this as possible. Now, second important thing is the soft law. Now, when we talk about the hard law, I don't know, because I understand that much of the audience here, they know about the hard law as well as the soft law. And hard law is, it is hard as that is law. That's all. Simply law. And what is soft law? Soft law is a law, and it to be a hard law at a particular point of time, we call this legiferandi. And the hardening process, how long it will take, we have no idea about it. So now, if you see that the environmental law, I said that it was a mixed feeling of failure as well as success. You will find in the realm of international environmental law, very less hard law. And everything is almost principles, that's all. Polluter pay principle, it's a principle. Sustainable development, a principle. Okay? So, all kinds of things, then common but differentiated responsibility. It is principle, that's all. So what happens is that, this everything is only the principle, and the principles need to be completely brought into the framework of a hard law by negotiation. So you have quite a lot of principles and the soft form of laws, but at the same time, it takes a lot of time to concretize, because so much of a planning as well as a spending money is necessary there. So it has not become hard law, but at the same time that these environmental soft laws can be made as hard law by the choice of the governments. The UN has made progress with its 8 Millennium Development Goals, which will be followed by 17 Sustainable Development Goals to enhance social, environmental, and economic progress by 2030. Don't know. Now after COVID, they think that it is not possible. Already it is not possible. And with the COVID dent, this could not be possible. But anyway, you have a structure, at least some principles, you can say that would form in future a law, or that can be selectively taken by the national governments to make it a law. But it could not stop the United States from abandoning even the hard law. See, this is what, the villain, we are talking about this, the hero and the villain in international relations, in a multilateral forum. Because, Kyoto Protocol, they withdrawn. And they have, in fact, ignoring the Comprehensive Nuclear Test Ban Treaty. biological weapons convention, they said that no, we will not, we will repudiate. Then they repealed anti-ballistic missile treaty. And the top of it, Bush was the only person as a president. He made it that a signed treaty can be unsigned. He made history. A signed treaty, he made a declaration unsigned. And it was not, you know, one cannot unsign. Then it went to the secretariat whether they could unsign. It is not possible in the treaty law. But if they reassert that, that no time they will sign it, maybe we will accept that. Then they come and say that at no time, we will be party to this, the ICC. They unsigned the Rome Statute. So what is the failure of UN? And if you look in, one is the peacekeeping, it's a failure. Why it is a failure? Because, you know, a lot of money is involved in that. They don't have a kind of a standing army. That is what, you know, Koteshwara was referring about as well as the DLS was referring about. And it is very costly. And you have to generate fund from the donor countries. Then another failure is the invasion of Iraq. So you can always find that, you know, the big boss, they join together because the working of the UN Security Council, it's very strange because you cannot even lie before a parliament, but you can lie before the horseshoe, the Security Council, and escape. This is what, you know, the Colin Ball did. I was there on the day. He said that as if, you know, the weapons of mass destruction is hidden somewhere in Iraq like that. And he has shown some kind of a video. Everybody is looking. And then they came out, nothing was visible, what this man is telling. But anyway, you know, this was P1 at the time, because it was powerful. Because, you know, P1 was the only Security Council member at that particular point of time, US was that powerful. They could not open their mouth. Then finally, all right, we will knock off Iraq. Understand? Then followed by Libya. Libya followed. So, ultimately, there must be some reason for that. And most importantly, there are economic reasons for that. At least there's some other occasion that we will discuss about that. So today, there is no conflict. Conflicts without end. And the environmental, as I told you earlier, that it is the development of stop general principles only might be transformed, if at all possible, to customary international law. Then, what is the hard law left there? Perhaps in environmental law, only hard law you can look for is the principles of a state responsibility and liability. These two things are hard law. Rest of the entire international environmental law, I would say that it is a soft law. And what is the success of this UN? I said here I am putting peacekeeping. I put failure also peacekeeping. I put success a peacekeeping, success environmental law. I put, you know, this failure environmental law. Because in somewhere it is success and somewhere it is a failure. But as far as the rest of the things are concerned, law of the sea, decolonization, human rights, free trade, anti-terrorism, in all fields, thorough success. Because all countries are interested in that. Okay. Say, for example, law of the sea, all the major countries are interested in that. When major countries are interested in that, they have to bargain. When they have to bargain, what they will do, they always make a kind of a basket. A basket with some fruits, which are all useful for one set of countries, some fruits that will be useful for some other kind of countries. So you take it as a basket. This is a negotiating tactics. And, you know, all right, everybody wants it. And everybody will be dissatisfied. But at the same time, they will say it is good. So in the negotiation, they say that a negotiation is a wonderful negotiation when the end point reaches and everybody is dissatisfied. If one person is, one country is satisfied in the negotiation, it is a failure of negotiation. Okay. So in all cases, you know, this law of the sea, decolonization, human rights, free trade, anti-terrorism, everybody wants that kind of a international law to govern. Okay. Then, if you see that further, and why this is happening, Why failure? And this was also identified very clearly by earlier speaker. One is the power. The second is national interest. And the power and national interest should die normally. When you make any constitution, the power as well as the interests of an individual that is completely sacrificed for the purpose of a creation of a normative order. That is what we understand in the municipal legal order is concerned. But here, the power and national interest, these are all the fundamental issues.
Sir, I think current cut, sir.
Is it?
Yes, sir, power cut.
Please stay tuned. Due to power failure, short time our Professor Gandhi will join us.
Failure. It is power failure. Failure, power, fire, power failure.
In short time, Professor Gandhi will join us.
Sir, shall I?
Stay tuned.
இது கொஞ்சம் வந்து பவர் டைம்
பாலாஜி பாலாஜி
சார் குட் ஈவினிங் சார்
Very good evening. How are you?
Sir, fine, sir. Thank you. Sir.
Good evening.
My audio is clear.
Sir, you are good. Yes, now on. Yes, video is coming.
Good evening, sir. Good evening, sir.
Audio and video.
Yes, sir. It's good perfect. Clear.
Audio and
video.
Good evening, sir.
Okay, sir. Good evening, sir.
यार
फोन भी करेंगे बाहर Thank you.
Oh, I'm sorry. Is it audible now? Is it audible?
Yes, audible. Audible.
It's audible. Audible.
This reminds us we are in India. So, you know,
Lightboard.
These are all things that will happen anyway. So, you know, why failure? You know, I was there. You know, reason was that the power was the power.
No problem.
And when you have power and national interest, and this can be avoided, but it so happened that the power and national interest can easily be, one is accepted internationally by states through two important principles of the charter. One is sovereignty and non-intervention. So with the result, what happens is that wherever when there is a problem, say for example, and most of you know, I don't want to get into too much into that, the relationship between Article 2, 4 and 51 of the UN Charter, because you know, then it will take you to some other place. But what is happening is that when the power, national interest, sovereignty, non-intervention, when these two things happens, and the states will always work on self-interest.
Next.
And they are too much worried about, you know, their allies also, if they want to just, you know, intervene in the affairs, whether it is lawful or otherwise. So with the results, you can see that only as far as the peacekeeping mission is concerned, in Cambodia, the peacekeeping mission ended violence, even in the peacekeeping mission. That's why I said that it is a failure as well as a success, I put it. And Pol Pot regime, by the time they executed 2.1 million people. In Rwanda, 800,000 were massacred in 100 days. Rwanda is where it is in Africa. I said, you know, if it is happening in Europe, that's a different issue altogether. Okay. And in Bosnia, what happens? In Srebrenica, you can find that the 8,000 Muslim men and boys, they massacred. In Darfur, 300,000 Sudanese civilians were killed. In Boko Haram has killed 13,000 people. And we see this recently, this inability to deal with crisis of ethnic cleansing in Rohingya Muslim in Myanmar. So see, if you see that, as far as the, this part is concerned, you know, the peacekeeping and, you know, rescuing people from the misery, and we have not in fact succeeded. But UN has succeeded. You can see that, you know, in body count in the deaths in Iraq, about 220,000 people they have killed. Afghanistan, 80,000. So this is all, you know, you can say that how the countries, you know, they work whenever their interests are affected. Now let us see, when we are talking about, you know, the international law, the soft as well as the hard law, and I said that this is an important aspect, the positive aspect of the UN. The reason is that you can openly discuss, and wherever you want a legal regime to be built in a particular area, you can do that. Article 13 of the Charter says that General Assembly shall initiate studies and make recommendations for the purpose of promoting international cooperation in the political field and encouraging progressive development of international law and its codification. In the political field, the outcome document of 2005, where, you know, responsibility to protect and, you know, the new direction to the UN that was given, that was a political document and that was adopted under Article 13. Then another thing you can see that in paragraph B, promoting international cooperation in the economic, social, cultural, educational, and health fields. And where, you know, there are so many things that have happened, but for UN, nothing would have happened there. And assisting in the realization of human rights and fundamental freedoms. And nobody will look into that if no such body like UN is there. So what is the hard law and soft law? Both hard law as well as a soft law can be made within the four walls of the UN, and it has been made all the time. The soft law developments are through the General Assembly resolutions and declarations. And from soft law, one can even emerge as a hard law, a customary international law. And the treaty laws can be made on the basis of a study and report. And if you see that UN in lawmaking, and it's all traversed from the International Law Commission to Sixth Committee, and from Sixth Committee to the plenary session of the General Assembly. And Sixth Committee, this is one way of doing it. The other way under rules you can do is the Sixth Committee proposal, and that will be given to the working group. The working group constituted in the Sixth Committee itself will work on that. And they draft a convention, and they, by consensus, they adopt. Almost all anti-terrorism conventions are adopted like this way. The another way you can find, there is a ILC draft, and this will go to the Sixth Committee, and Sixth Committee will appoint their plenipotentiary conference, and it will be adopted by convention, adopted by consensus. And these are all has been done in case of a law of the sea, as well as the Rome Statute, because the plenipotentiary meeting was not held within the four walls of UN, but it was held in Rome there. That's why, you know, it gets a name, Rome Statute. So there is a settled procedure, the UNGA rules of procedure. It is something like, you know, what you have. The format is something like a parliamentary procedure. Therefore, it is very easy, and it is a rule-based game as far as the lawmaking within the multilateral forum is concerned. But whereas in the bilateral and plurilateral rulemaking or lawmaking, this is absolutely a different ball game. Even outside the UN also, now the treaties are made. Say, for example, and treaties are made even outside the UN, and most of them are, you know, like the cluster munition, there is a treaty on that. And a similar way, the treaties are made outside the UN, but at the same time, and they will adopt their own rules. They won't follow the rules of the game, whatever is placed in the UN. So the lawmaking in all allied agencies also almost like the same pattern. And that is like Outer Space Legal Subcommittee, lawmaking in UNESCO, lawmaking ICAO, lawmaking IMO, lawmaking in UNEP. Little change in the process might be there, but it is the same way they do it. So the rules of procedure of the conference will be developed and adopted by a deliberative body. Mostly law is made by consensus and voting. So the contribution, if you talk about, I told you, there are certain success stories on international lawmaking. At the same time, what is important is the streamlining a process and the procedure for lawmaking. It is on the lines of the parliamentary practice of any developed country. So in that way, you know, I think that is a success, and it is a hallmark, and it is going to be there in the same way. So almost the contribution on international law, especially as a multilateral forum, if every state is interested on that, and they can always make a law. I think to sum up, there are success and failure stories as far as the UN is concerned, but as far as in the international lawmaking, and the significant contribution is on the human development issues, like human rights, like, you know, the goals you said, like economic, social, and cultural rights and promotion. And you can say that the women and children, they will have right. And all these things can be done. It had been done. Without the UN, you can't think of it. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for explaining UN and international law, difficulties of UN in the 75th year, and the impressive progress of UN and prevention of world war and the future success of UN. Thank you once again, sir. We are at immense pleasure to have got an opportunity to attend this expertise. Professor Dr. A. David Ambrose, former head, Department of Legal Services, University of Madras, has about 22 years of PG teaching in law, guided more than 30 PhD scholars, and judged finals of more than 100 moot court competitions, including the Indian national rounds of the prestigious Philip C. Jessup Commonwealth and Stetson International Environmental Law Moot Court competitions. His accomplishments dates back to holding first rank in ML examination, doctoral fellowship at the Huge Academy of International Law, Hague, Netherlands, on private and public international law, and still holds membership of prestigious institutions, including Indian Society of International Law, New Delhi, and Indian Institute of Law, New Delhi. He hits on the nail and calls a spade, which enlightens his guidance. Privileged and honored to have respectful Dr. David Ambrose, sir, to enlighten us.
Thank you. Good evening to one and all. Am I audible? Fine.
Yes, Professor. You are audible, Professor.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah. Very good evening to one and all. I'm immensely delighted to be part of this celebration of the 75th year of UN, that we are celebrating the United Nations. I have to congratulate the Government Law College, Chennai, now it is Aaron Patrapadamudur, for successfully conducting this webinar. Most respected director of WSC is my good friend, Santosh Kumar, and my immediate senior in the department, Mr. M.K. Rao, who delivered the inaugural address, and my teacher who taught me the basics of international law when I was an undergraduate student at Pondicherry Law College, and now he is dean of the prestigious VIT law school, Dr. M. Gandhi, and my classmate Chokalyan, now the principal of this great institution which is conducting this webinar. Dr. Balaji, again my student in the Department of Legal Studies, now he is the professor of the Ambedkar, professor of international law at the Ambedkar, Tamil Nadu Ambedkar Law University. And again, my another two students, namely Dr. Rai Shagar and Dr. Amrudalinga, will be enlightening you on several issues. And the vote of thanks will be delivered by, I believe, Dr. Anita Fabiola and Dr. Charanya and Dr. Balaji, who are directly involved in organizing these things. And I congratulate you for having successfully, we are halfway through conducting this webinar. At the outset, I am very happy that I am thankful to the organizers, especially my good friend and my classmate, the principal, Dr. Chokalingam. So we discussed it at length, and we accepted their invitation. So now the topic of the webinar is success of the UN, its future challenges. So I think that whether we have to go for whether it is a success or failure, let us not go into those details. We presume that it is success. That is why the title of the webinar also suggests so. Tamil Nadu, Nidaloda Aruma Veyila Thaan Theriyumnu Solvaanga. Nidaloda Aruma. So the worth of the shadow will be highly felt when you are traveling in a hot sun or when you are in hot sun. So rightly pointed out by my teacher, Dr. Gandhi. So imagine a situation when there is no UN at all. So that is what. So we have an institution. Today we are living in the era of institution. We are talking about institutionalized lawmaking. Those who understand the international lawmaking process in the yesterday decades, rather at least of before UN. Customary law was in the direct driving seat. So customary international law was given primacy over treaty law. So we know the interrelationship between customary law and treaty law, the entangled treaty and customary law as the shoe chatter. So we have when the treaty law become a customary law, when the treaty law will sunk to the level of customary international law, all these things we discussed earlier. But thanks to institutionalized lawmaking, starting from the League of Nations and the ILO, and coming to now today, we are dealing with institutionalized lawmaking. That is what Dr. Gandhi also highlighted. So we are having institutional lawmaking. We are specialized institutions, UN institutions. They immediately, thanks to new diplomacy also, immediately we have legal binding obligations or international legal binding obligations are created. So I would like to recall Dr. Binchak's observation referring to the General Assembly 1967 General Assembly resolution relating to outer space, use of outer space and celestial bodies for peaceful purposes. Is that instant customary international has been created. Because the two interested, as well as the two countries which are the capabilities of the outer space or space technology, namely then the USSR and the USA, they jointly they proposed a resolution and the every state accepted it. So there's an instant customary international has been developed. So very similar to that, we are talking about instant international international obligations are created because thanks to the new diplomacy. Because in every 10 years, for example, in the case of environment, every 10 years, starting from 1972, Stockholm Declaration, every 10 years we are having international conventions. And now, unlike the yester decades, rather, the heads of the states themselves participate in the negotiations or in the discussion. And when there is a consensus and writing, and everybody signature, irrespective of the fact whether they are ratified or not, whatever it is, they say in principle, going by the Vienna Convention of treaties, when you sign, so you can't do anything against the spirit of the particular treaty or multilateral treaty or etc. All these things. And thanks to our vibrant judiciary, now these treaties, even though they are not ratified by virtue of Article 51A. The Supreme Court, every now and then they incorporate these treaties as if they are customary law, a part of the law of land, and auto incorporation treaty has been invoked. So this institutionalized lawmaking as one of the greatest contribution of the United Nations, and that is what we are talking about. And the United Nations depends upon largely on whatever we call it as it. So after 1947, decolonization took place, and the least developing countries or newly developed countries, especially from Afro-Asian countries, all these things they wanted somewhere to. So far, they were thought that they were not part. They were only not subjects of international law. Suddenly, they got freedom and they become subjects of international law, and they saw this UN as their savior, champion, or that they can enforce their interest and safeguard their interest. Then the sovereign equality, the cardinal principle of UN, one vote in the General Assembly, forget about UN, Security Council, where there is a veto, one country, one vote, the sovereign equality of the equality principle. All these things that the newly independent states enjoy. Therefore, they wanted some reforms in international law. They wanted the reforms in especially the economic forums. That is why they called for new international economic order, order of economic rights and duties, and also the nationalization of foreign property compensation. They wanted to remove all rule and bring the prompt, adequate, and effective compensation principle. They negotiated lump sum agreements, and they wanted to bring the appropriate compensation, later appropriate compensation according to international law, appropriate compensation according to the nationalizing state or whatever it is, and later on, and it slowly faded away. But this is also, we have seen with reference to the new things, the access and benefit sharing, AVEO protocol and other things. The third world countries, which are rich in the biological resources, they said that they thought this is a green petrol or a green gold they have, so they can get a lot of money out of this access and benefit sharing. So they were like this, and they wanted to have this, but later on the access and benefit sharing, right to have access and benefit sharing slowly, that is what we have seen. The success of, according to me, as a student of international law, I would also be by supporting the Professor Kelsen. So Kelsen belongs to the Analytical School of Jurisprudence. normally they say international law is not a true law, and they follow monism, dualism. International law is different from municipal law. International law is not a law at all. International law is a vanishing point of jurisprudence. International law is a weak law. International law is only, it is not a law, it's only a positive morality, etc., etc., all these things. I find that Kelsen, one exception in Kelsen, because Kelsen was living in Vienna, that is Europe, during the interwar period. He's the only person who said international law and municipal law are one and the same, and he gave some recognition to international law for the simple reason he believed only international can bring peace to that particular region. Because the time he was living during the interwar period between First World War and Second World War. Secondly, he was living in the war torn area, that is in Europe. So he personally believed the mandate that international municipal law are one and the same. And for the simple reason, the municipal law is the interest of the individuals directly, as international is taking care of what Gandhi, Professor Gandhi rightly put, the human development, not directly through the nation states or through the municipal states. So he visualized international as a true law because he was living during the interwar period. And today also we can have so many things to counter the to criticize the views of the analytical school of Tunis from the analytical school, that is international law. We have sanctions, we have economic sanction, international is not a weak law, etc. So many criticism can be leveled against the criticisms of the so-called the analytical school of the protagonists of analytical school of jurisprudence. Leave that apart. Now we see international law is because the role of the state has been changed vastly. Earlier, the role of the state or the function of the state was according to Solomon, it is one war and justice. That's all. Justice that is the look within the internal sovereignty and external sovereignty. Today we talk about war is nothing but the external sovereignty, and today I mean the welfare state. So we moved from the 14th century, we were in the trade state, then we moved to the police state, then we moved to laissez-faire state. Now we are in a welfare state. The concept of welfare state, and the state has to cater to the needs of the people. And that is why the state is not only a protector, now it is also a provider. The services, it is dealing with services. All these things become the function of the state. So now the U.S. was seen as a first of all, the newly independent states saw in their opinion that UN was their only savior. They thought UN could save their through UN. They can achieve, their interests can be protected, because sometimes their economy was so poor than the their annual budget was far less than the annual turnover of a multinational corporation. So they were exploited, their natural resources were exploited, and all these things. So they thought through UN only they can claim the development, or they can achieve some development, whatever cooperation or whatever it is they thought. So from this perspective only, the success of my feeling is, my understanding is, so we have the chapter 7, the objective of UN to maintain the peace and security, that is what it says. And we have rightly pointed out, we have the objective of UN is to maintain that is human rights and fundamental freedoms, etc., etc. So now, since the states, those who are not interested, those who are not having the military powers, they wanted to concentrate on their economic development rather than military development. For them and for their development, economic as well as other development, so the UN was a forum for them. The UN was a forum to put forth their interest and to some extent, to succeed in this respect also. So the success of UN was so far has been based on its multilateral approach. this was not new. Every General Assembly, the President of General Assembly, the General Assembly every now and then, they say, oh, the success of UN is that is multilateral approach. That is what we see. So when we go for multilateral approach, so this is today it has been threatened and rightly pointed out by my preceding speakers. It has been affected by nationalism and national jurisdiction. I'll come to that later because I have been asked to focus on one particular area by the organizers. So therefore, I'll be focusing on that particular point. But nevertheless, when you talk about multilateral approach or multilateralism within the framework of United Nations, three things come into my mind. So what is multilateral approach or multilateralism? First one is we opt for, one is dialogue. So we dialogue, that is what the political organ of United Nations, that is General Assembly, they discuss, deliberate, dialogue, whatever it is. Then the second one is negotiations. And the third one is international cooperation. So for major part, Professor Gandhi was talking about this international cooperation on many things, because today when things are spilling out of your jurisdiction, then you have to seek for international cooperation. When we are talking about pollution in the ICs, pollution in the atmosphere, in the commons, what we call commons, common concern of mankind, we have moved from common heritage of mankind, from the exploitation point of view to the common concern of mankind, from the conservation point of view. So that is what the paradigm shift as far as the exploitation to conservationism. So that is what you should appreciate. So dialogue and negotiations and international cooperation are the three pillars with reference to multilateralism, which contribute for the success of the United Nations. So with respect to the sovereignty also, one major contribution I wish to point out is what I say is, so earlier we thought sovereignty means domestic jurisdiction. Nobody has power. It falls within my domestic jurisdiction. Therefore, nobody can question it. Even we were talking about with reference to non-international armed conflict within the states. The state itself is indulging in terrorism, which we call terrorism. The government is indulging in genocide, what we have seen in Balkan, Rwanda, etc., etc. And the international community was a mute spectator. Many people died. Many, not simply human rights violation, gross violation of human rights took place, and international community could not do anything. Thanks to what has happened in the NATO bombing, after that, the international community, it was an eye-opener for the international community. And I said, now thanks, there are about 10 to 15, I think 13 reports are developed by the prepared by the United General, that Secretary General of the United Nations. So today we are saying that response, that the sovereignty includes responsibility, that is responsibility to protect its own citizens from the grave violations of human rights that we call the gross atrocity crimes, that is what mass atrocity crimes, mass atrocity crimes. The state has a responsibility to protect. When you assert your sovereignty has other side also, responsibility. So when the responsibility, if you are not able to fulfill it, then the international community or the humanitarian intervention can be affected or whatever it is. This is the one thing that is what earlier we thought we saw only exception to 2-4 was Article 51. Now we are saying that if there is a gross violation of, or if there is a mass atrocity crimes committed by a particular state, then in any state or international or through the Security Council, collective measures can be taken against these particular things. So this is with reference to military, peace and security, etc., etc. So reverting back to these particular things, today we are seized with many things. One is, and the international community is seized with three important things. That is, one is with reference to the pandemic situation. The second one is with reference to Dr. Gandhi also freely citing on this, climate change, and also to some extent nuclear threat, whatever it is, nuclear warfare. So now we are talking about climate change. infectious disease and nuclear weapons. All these are the some of the things which we have to see whether the success of the United Nations is there. When I say I have passed in the examinations, I may have passed with 100% marks, I have passed with 80% of marks, I would have passed with about 60% of marks or 40% of marks. So even if I score 40%, I say I have, because that is the minimum pass, so I passed. So it is the rate of success or the degree of success depends upon the yardstick which you fix. So this is one thing we should appreciate. So if you want to measure the success of the United Nations, first you have to fix a yardstick. So what is it, 40%, 60%, whatever it is. Professor Gandhi was, in his approach, he said, with reference to environmental law, partly success and partly it was not so encouraging. I cannot say it is failure. So encouraging, whatever it is, to be a moderate things. Failure, not to that extent, not up to the expectation, rather we say not up to the expectation. So failure, if the failure is hard, we can use that not up to the expectation, we may stay. So this is multilateral approach is in fact has resulted in getting the international cooperation. Today, to some extent, we are talking about international law of cooperation. That's what. So we have moved from international law of war, international law of peace, and J.W. Denning said it is international law of whatever with reference to labor law, and he said international law of the social security or whatever it is. Today we are emphasizing a cooperation at all level. It is not duty based. It is not right based. First generation, second generation human rights. It is not duty based. It is not right based. Today we are talking about cooperation at all level. So this cooperation is achieved through dialogue and negotiations. When there is a consensus, it is all these things. So first of all, the United Nations has been seen as a forum for dialogue, especially from the developing and least developing countries, where they can at least air their views to the international community. At least they can make the international community feel what they feel. So that is what one attitude. Sometimes we say at least somebody is listening. I am allowed to speak. So that kind of a satisfaction is these countries in a diplomatic manner. They say I am also in a diplomatic process. I am also part of this diplomatic process within the framework of United Nations. They are very happy. They also become members of various committees, and also they also work. They also get the recognition. All these things, this dialogue helps them to be a part of diplomatic process. And after diplomatic process, the culmination of diplomatic process, we say policy will result in the law, from the municipal law analogy. So the diplomatic process will culminate in the form of a international treaty or whatever it is. So they are happy that they are also part of in the international lawmaking for that reason. The second important thing is with reference to that is I will be, because I've been asked to by the organizer to focus on one or two issues, that is environment and especially climate change. So that is what I have taken, because these are three issues which is pressing us: climate change and the infectious disease, that is this COVID pandemic, and nuclear weapons, and also the weather, the use of force, whether the United Nations has stopped the use of force, unilateral use of force. All these things we have to discuss. That part, unilateral use of force, is different. So that is ultimately diplomacy, diplomatic channel, and also power, military power. So coming back to the climate change and infectious disease, especially the climate change, this dialogue and negotiation and pressing for international cooperation has been met with success. That's what we can say. Because of the UNFCCC, the United Nations Framework Convention on the Climate Change, and also mitigation adoption areas, and also the Paris, the adoption of Paris Treaty or whatever it is, we say this is all because based on the negotiations, based on the dialogue, and international consensus has been reached, international cooperation has been reached, etc., etc., immediately. pending obligations has been created, all these things we are talking about, all these things. So now coming to this Paris Convention, whatever is the earlier thing is only in principle, at least in principle they agreed, like the precautionary principle, polluter pays principle, all these things, and they now the common but differential responsibility, all these things, because they say most of the countries have become developed, industrialized rather, so therefore they are the culprits. Their emission of carbon has resulted in the rise of temperature, rise of carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, and that they should put the responsibility, or share the responsibility for the cost. That is why as a fair and equitable things, they said that is common. The responsibility to bring down the carbon emission or decarbonization is common responsibility for everybody. But based on the economic conditions, something we see in our part four, the whatever seen in the part four, the state can implement subject to this. That is what normally we say with reference to the right to education. Also, we say right to education up to the age of 14 years is permissible. After that, because it depends upon the economic conditions of the resources of the state. So that is what normally we say. I just give an analogy. So based on that, based on the economic development, based on their past history, how much they contributed for the present day confusion or present day problem. Keeping all this mind in a fair and equitable manner, that is common but differential responsibility, decarbonization or whatever it is. So now the Paris, what happened in the Paris Convention is everybody, that is what I would like to highlight. So yeah, now in principle they agreed, but when it came to implementation, because it has to be implemented within the domestic sphere and domestic sphere, you know, lobbies are there. Your domestic thing is dominated by lobby, your economic interest, your national interest, nationalism, your whatever it is, interest, all these things has been seen in this thing. So that is why in 1995, so they, what is what has based on a negotiation, in a negotiation, many people, now we know the negotiations with reference to Uruguay round of negotiations culminated in the establishment of WTO. So the negotiations, when you go for negotiation, you should know what is your best interest. So in a negotiation, especially from the trade negotiation point of view, it is a win-win situation for everybody. So that is, nobody is a loser and nobody is a winner. You give and take. What is your interest, you take. Other things you give up. Or that is what normally when we talk about, we understand by trade negotiations. The win-win situation, whatever that Dr. Professor Gandhi also highlighted this point, that is in a negotiation, one country wins means other countries are things. So it's a win-win, give and take. Also, what is the bare minimum for us? I will not give an inch of that ground. Then whatever it is, the additional things, whatever it is, I will go there. So the major part with reference to this, given that now we are talking about with reference to terrorism also, the regionalism is coming. So that is, now we are talking about within the UN framework, multilateralism versus regionalism or nationalism, whatever it is. Not national regionalism or nationalism. So the Arab countries are not accepting with reference to one man's freedom fighters, another man's, same old the theories have been put forth, same old arguments have been put forth. So that is what, when I go for a negotiation, I accept some international responsibility, later I realize, oh, that is not suitable for me. So that is what the position of America is now like that. So they are thinking that withdrawing from the, they threaten withdrawing from the World Health Organization, WTO, and in fact, they have withdrawn from the Paris 2017. The Trump administration also started the process of withdrawing from the Paris Treaty or whatever it is. So this is when they come, whatever it is. But the highlight of the Paris Treaty is that the states have been allowed to set their own commitments. So they by reducing their carbon use. So this is what my common by responsibility has been given a go by, whatever it is. The states understanding the importance of mitigating the or addition, not adaptation or mitigating. So they thought that the carbon emission should be brought down. So they were allowed to set their own commitments. This is what we are talking about. They had their own commitments. So in this respect, the Barack or the Obama administration accepted 26 to 28% reduction of what has happened, what was there in 2005 in 2025. But the problem here is that is what the international cooperation was hard to organize and sustain. This is the problem we are facing. So international cooperation was there, but it was hard to organize and sustain this problem we are facing, because the targets have been set, but for various reasons it could not be reached. And according to the statistics, only 15 to 19% of the target accepted, that is what 26 to 28 from 2005 standards to 2025 standards. So even the America was able to achieve these things. So in this aspect, really, when the international cooperation is hard to organize and sustain, so we are talking about the negotiations, the negotiation process. Dialogue and negotiations is very much, it comes from the things, whatever. So that is why today, even though there is no international cooperation, whatever it is, so we are talking about within the framework of United Nations, we are talking about episodic multilateralism. This is what some of the new authors are following, this episodic, like episodes, one episode, second episode, separate part or events in the multilateralism. That is what episodic multilateralism is being taught, because international community, so for example, we know the development of human rights, it was a painful birth, difficult and struggled growth, we know. If you analyze the development of human rights, it is a painful birth. Several lakhs of people died, devastating effect of Second World War. Then it struggled to growth. Then the dichotomous approach, first generation, second generation, third generation human rights, from the natural right to legal rights, so many difficulties that human rights faced. But nevertheless, it overcame all these challenges. Similar to that, today we are facing in a multilateralism versus regionalism. We are facing, because the when we accept, if I do not accept these responsibilities, which is beyond my goes beyond my territorial limitation, then it will be gloom for the entire mankind. Therefore, I accept it. And when it comes to implementation, I'm not able to do it. I'm not also willing to do it, or not able to do it, or whatever it is. This is the part we are facing, whatever it is. So this is the episodic multilateralism. So we later on, it is now not sporadic, episodic. So later on, we'll have a regular cooperation in the multilateralism. Now, the every state will have to give and take. That negotiations will take place, and they will accept or understand, give and take, whatever it is. All this the negotiation, these all things will take place. So, from this perspective only, we have to see the success, whether UN is successful or not, whether it's successful or not, and for the future, whatever it is, apart. I'm not going to the military purposes, because all my three speakers, learned speakers before me, who spoke eloquently and also they spoke elaborately on the point. The allotted field for me is environment, sustainable development, and the climate change. Then what is the contribution of United Nations, etc. And we know two important UN organizations, that is what United Nations Development Program, UNDP, and also the UNEP. These are the two international United Nations organizations, specialized agencies, rather, I put it that way. So they have done a commendable job with respect to environmental law, protection of environmental law, as well as with reference to reducing environmental degradation, etc., etc. In fact, they have done a human service in this related or allotted field or whatever it is, of the United UNDP as well as UNEP, and the environmental program, whatever it is. So now, many a times we see the interests of the Americans are suffering. So they are saying so now to what extent? So this is what the normally we say. So what extent the other states will see this particular state, which says my nationalism is I am putting my nationalism before the multilateralism. So this is what one thing. This is public thing normally in the era of information technology and etc. So this is the media plays a vital role in projecting America is wrong. America should not pull out from the World Health Organization. They should be they should try to accommodate their interests within the all these things we are talking about. From this perspective, the future challenge of the so far you might have made out my submission is with respect to environment, climate change, and other things. The success story of United Nations is overwhelming. Not complete or 100%. I can say it is encouraging, even not overwhelming. It is that's why I said what yardstick you are going to fix. So it is encouraging. So without the multilateralism, without negotiations, without dialogue, without cooperation, we could not achieve it. Because what is happening in ISIS? What is happening in atmosphere? We may not control. We're sitting in India. We may not even know what is. We may not even have the scientific data. We may not even have the technical know-how. All these things. So we have to pool our energies. That is what international cooperation through dialogue, negotiation, and international cooperation. So the international cooperation is being to some extent that is the future of what is lying ahead of these things. So that is what the multilateralism versus the nationalism or whatever it is. So this is what the problem is. So one solution now we are thinking that is what episodic multilateralism. That is what separate parts or separate events which can become later on be accommodated in the multilateral. Earlier we said with reference to environmental law, we said sectoral approach. When there is even there is no consensus on universal, that is why we made a distinction between internationalization of human rights and universalization of human rights. Internationalization of human rights was achieved easily, but universalization of human rights was not achieved easily. So that is why now this universalization, that is why we said sectoral approach. Whenever there was a consensus, immediately it was reduced in the form of a treaty or a convention or a declaration. Everybody accepted it. Therefore, the Child Rights Convention and the CEDAW, all these things we can give Professor Gandhi gave a statistics about the number of treaties, which are bilateral, multilateral treaties relating to human rights protection. So I don't want to go into the details. So we had the international community within the framework of United Nations. We opted for what is sectoral approach. Then we sorted out the problem. So these challenges have been these challenges are new to international community. So the because ultimately. We want peace. We would like to lead. That is what the basic understanding of international law, not justice but peace, maintenance of peace and security. That is why Professor Kelson also want from the peace point of view. He said international law is law, and international law and municipal law are one and the same. So that the problem which we are facing is that how to accommodate this nationalism within the multilateralism. So one thing is that is the episodic multilateralism can be an answer, but in the process by the grace of the Almighty God, the wisdom will prevail. So we need cooperation. We cannot live in isolation. So that is what the committee needs. It international cooperation is essential for survival. One country cannot survive yet. So that is what the success of the United Nations and the IC, the future challenges to human of the United Nations. So I'm very glad, and from the depth of my heart, I thank the organizer for giving me a chance to air my thoughts on this on the success and the future of United Nations, and which I've been teaching, I have been learning for last 3 decades or so. So I'm very thankful to the organizers. I'm thankful to all the audience. I see a lot of audience are there. And I thank you for these things. Thank you very much.
Saranya.
Good evening, Professor. This is Amir Daling, Professor.
Thank you, David Ambrose, sir, for explaining.
Nobody has heard. It's possible to talk about that.
Thank you, David Ambrose, sir, for explaining us the pillars of multilateralism and also explaining on the recent climatic change and finishing it up with the COVID issue. Today marks the Platinum Jubilee of United Nations. Hence, as an honor to celebrate and also to understand the goal, the workshop focuses on success of the United Nations and its future challenges. The technical sessions will start now. Since we are running scarcity of time, we request the panelists to take 15 minutes each. The members, the participants, if you are having any query, you can please drop the questions in the chat box. Our Professor Balaji, Dr. T. Balaji sir, would ask the questions on your behalf. Please don't try to unmute yourself. Thank you. We are honored to have Professor Dr. S. Amardalingam, sir, who completed his master's at the University of Madras, practiced at High Court of Madras, and then started his academic career as a lecturer in law. He has also coordinated in various moot court competitions, including Commonwealth Moot Court Competition. He was consultant in many projects, including the government of Tamil Nadu in the scheme of JNURM, which is the rent control laws. With such expertise in practical knowledge, we are honored to have him share a few of his experiences here.
Good evening, and am I audible, Balaji sir?
Sir, yes, sir. Yes, sir. It's audible.
Thank you. Good. So, good evening, the organizers and all learned legal luminaries, Mr. Kotisar Rao sir and Professor Gandhi and Dr. David Ambrose, to whom I learned the fundamentals of public international law. And special thanks to our Director of Legal Studies, Dr. Shandu sir, and the Principal of Pattray Perumbatur Government Law College, Dr. Songalikim sir, our other organizing team. So due to paucity of time, let me confine with only one core called how the international economic institutions lead to achieve the purposes and the principles of the United Nations Charter. So with this, let me share my screen. Yes. So as I had mentioned earlier, so all these things were highlighted by starting from Kotisar Rao sir based on his vast experience and Dr. Gandhi sir based on his practical experience in the discipline of international economic law and the other basics which were highlighted by Dr. David Ambrose sir. The core I am going to confine with, what are the interface or interrelations between GATT, World Trade Organization and the United Nations Charter. So if you take the United Nations Charter, it's not a specialized institution. So United Nations Charter simply says it could make only for the specialized agencies. So what is the status of Bretton Woods system? What is the status of GATT? What is the status of World Trade Organization? If its status or their status are not decided, the simple question would arose why they have to work for achieving the purposes and principles of the Charter. The second one is, what are the coherences which were made during the negotiation of the World Trade Organization and the conversation which were had between the members of the United Nations and the members of the World Trade Organization. The last and final one is, what are the contributions of the World Trade Dispute Settlement Body for the purposes and principles of the Charter. With this, let me start. Okay, so due to paucity of time, I made it very nutshell because things are. This particular forum is not for only the law students. I thought I can give some fundamentals for. In the left side, I made it the United Nations Charter. As our Professor Gandhi sir had made it very specific, the objectives or preamble of the charter is there. In the right side, I concentrated more on Bretton Woods system. In the Bretton Woods system, I am going to concentrate only on two, IMF and IBRD, because the students of international law might know GATT is not an institution, it's only an instrument. But from 1945 till 1986, that's last round of Uruguay round, there are many deliberations were held. Why? They thought along with the United Nations Charter, there should be an economic institutions like ILO. ILO safeguard the interests of laborers. The United Nations discusses on political issues, as Professor Gandhi sir and Kotisar Rao sir and Amru sir had made it very specific, negotiation, diplomacy. So these aspects concentrated more on how the political decision could be made in a platform. It could lead to achieve the purposes and principles, especially Article 1 and 2, all 4 plus 7. Therefore, they felt they should create some institutions like International Trade Organization, but it was not materialized. So what was an outcome? The outcome of the Marrakesh Agreement was the World Trade Organization. How it was transformed? There are many confusions among us, the non-public international law student, GATT as if was an institution. So GATT was not an institution. It was an agreement which facilitated the trade negotiation between and among us, the states, or whoever considered as a party to the general agreement on tariff and trade, they can do various aspects with the permission and restrictions. When I said permission and restrictions, there are measures which says state can impose. So one of the best example, as our Gandhi sir had rightly pointed out, using the hard law approaches, state can take some bilateral investment treaties, or not to satisfy with the hard law approach, they can take some soft law approach, in a way blend hard law treaties. The best example, even Professor Ambrose had it very specific, CBD and UNFCCC. So till 1992, these documents were. Why I said these things? Exceptions. Any sovereign state, as a contracting state to the general agreement on tariff and trade, they can impose any form of restrictions. Was it a good or bad? It was not finalized till the formation of the World Trade Organization. So we know World Trade Organization, along with other covered agreement, it was established. Now I am going to make a link. As I had it very specific, United Nations Organization does not specify the economic institutions or specialized agencies. Then how they have to work? Where only I have read the other two articles from our United Nations Charter itself. So what are the articles? 57 from Chapter 9 and 63 from Chapter 10. So these two articles says why the Economic and Social Council as a principal organ has to establish any specialized agencies. The role of a specialized agency is to determine economic, social, cultural interest of the state party to the United Nations Charter. But till 1994, there was no coordination. For the first time, the coordination began between the United Nations Organization and the World Trade Organization only pointing out. Okay, so now I made very specific. United Nations Organization has no need to rework the core of the United Nations Charter till 1994. But how they will, even there is a specific restrictions in the World Trade Organization for original membership as well as accession. Who can be original membership or who are considered as original member, who are considered a member who can access. Where Article 8 put it very specific, with these limitations. It's not like what Montevideo Convention 1933 describes. What do you mean by a state? Who call may be allowed to enjoy the status of statehood in international law? It's not. Okay. So therefore, any state which has demarcated custom territory, they are authorized to be a member or access the World Trade Organization Agreement. Like the World Trade Organization Agreement, there are multiple covered agreements. let me say covered agreements. Covered agreements are nothing but annexures. There are many annexures. The best example I can give here, GATS, TRIPS, TRIMS, SPS, DBT, and other things. Okay, this is not relevant for today's discussion. Why I made it very specific, as our Professor Gandhi sir had made it very specific, Article 13, subclause 2 says, the General Assembly may make any form of recommendations for the purpose of ensuring economic, social, and cultural aspects. So therefore, the General Assembly thought, yes, there should be a coordination. There should be a cooperation. Without coordination, cooperation, and coherence among us various member states of the United Nations and the World Trade Organization, the World Trade Organization might not commit for 4+7. Okay? So therefore, in the year 1994, both these Secretary General and Secretary General of the United Nations Charter, United Nations, and the Director General of the World Trade Organization made these analysis. Good. So now we can understand, yes, United Nations General Assembly can direct the World Trade Organization members to work with various core of the developments. As Dr. Gandhi sir had made it very specific, some aspects like Millennium Development Goals 2005, Sustainable Development Goals 2015, all these 8 old goals and new 17 goals is nothing but the mandated for all the members of the World Trade Organization. So how these mandated are achieved? I am going to focus only one area because when our director sir had began the United Nations institutions is a weakened body. There are many issues. They themselves could not make a harmony. Only strong states are taking an advantage. Even respond the same, Mr. Kotisar Rao sir and Gandhi sir made some nutshell, but I'm confined with economic aspects. Okay? So even states like United States of America having some hard law approaches in the covered agreements, they are about to come out. Even within the last 4 years of Donald Trump regime, he himself made it very specific in many fora because he felt it's a coercive. Why it is coercive? I'm going to focus only with our World Trade Organization dispute settlement understanding. Okay. So I think already made it. It's mandated. That's what even I had said. Okay. So there is a mandate for the World Trade Organization members to work with the United Nations organizations. Because though Security Council is an authorized body to revisit or enforce all 4+7, there are places where it is mentioned, as our Gandhi sir and Ambrose sir had made it, chapter 7, Pacific Settlement of Disputes. If it is any political issues, yes, Article 33 of the United Nations Charter says they can exhaust various measures, starting from conciliation, negotiation, mediation, inquiry, regional institutions. If all are could not provide any measures effectively, then they can think of international institutions. But what's an advantage? Is it good? Are we getting a real remedy? Definitely not. Because as our Rao sir had made it very specific, International Court of Justice. Though there are jurisdictions conferred where state alone be the party, ipso facto, the other members think of to take some advice. But where is the choice for an enforcement? If our Gandhi sir said, even states like America, when Palin herself produced some evidence as if it was not done, nothing would happen. So therefore, taking all these flaws in the global institutions like United Nations, the members of the World Trade Organization created an amazing institution which has a cohesive mechanism called dispute settlement. Why these dispute settlements should work? Only for confining with the sustainable development goals. That's what I began. As our professor said, sustainable development goals, it's only a hard law. Sorry, it's only a soft law. It would not make any bindingness. From 1972, we have a regular conferences like Stockholm, Rio, Nairobi, even Johannesburg, and 2012, Rio+20. So these documents revisit various principles like precaution, voluntary principle, common but differentiated responsibility, right to development, why the trade measures should be or shouldn't be a unilateral measures. Let me confine with only two principles from our Rio Declaration 1992. Principle 4 and Principle 12. These says trade and development should be an integral part. And Principle 12 says no states are authorized to make unilateral measures. Please understand. What is the crux of Rio? It's only a soft law. Where we can get a familiarity with the trade aspects only from hard law treaties. That's World Trade Organization or Marrakesh Agreement. Still what was made. Where only us, both the professors had made it very specific. Soft law approach to hard law approach, transformation. Again, Principle 25 of Rio Declaration. What does it say? Peace, development and environmental protection are indivisible, interdependent and inalienable. So therefore, whoever are parties to the World Trade Organization have no authority to say, yes, we will not obey for any objectives or principles of the United Nations Charter. Therefore, we will do ourselves. No. So therefore, there was a coherence process which were discussed among the member states for ensuring these things out of 17. How the dispute settlement helps, that I'll explain. Okay. This is a place where I am making a harmonization process. How the World Trade Organization dispute settlement body as an institution created with an intent to achieve a different purpose, effectively contributing for the United Nations purposes. Okay? Because unless a global order is not realized or targeted or assumed, whatever task or achievement, whichever basis states are doing, it's not relevant here. Okay? So though all these mandated are arising out of a soft law instruments too, because I used something different, mandated and soft law instrument. When there is a question of ratification process, as Vienna Convention on Law of Treaty says, okay, it is impossible for the state to revisit. So therefore, whatever sources we did familiarize with in our charter, it's applicable for dispute settlement. Then there are no proper demarcation when there is a question of sources in the name of hard and soft law. Because text like Stockholm Declaration, Rio Declaration, UNFCC, UNCBD, all these used are the primary sources. Then with respect to VCLT, Article 31, 32, 33 of the interpretation techniques. Then lex specialis, no. The last and final things, how these decisions are implemented. Okay. So compared to United Nations, our Security Council and the International Court of Justice, with that of World Trade Organization Dispute Settlement Body, World Trade Dispute Settlement Body is the coercive one. It's a coercive one. Okay. So no state may say we will not. But we have a direct articles. Due to paucity of time, I'm not ready to repeat everything. I'll share the PPT with our organizers, especially Dr. Balaji and our principals are. So whoever wants to please read. So articles 21 and 22 of the agreement, which says it should be implemented, compensated. If they exceed, the suspension of concession might be. Then how many cases? You make a comparison. If you take United Nations Charter or International Court of Justice, from 1945 till December 2019, they made only 178 cases out of 193 countries. Okay, out of all about 75 years as on today, because we are in 75th year. So therefore, they have made only 178 cases. But if you take a history of the World Trade Organization Dispute Settlement Body, from 1995 till December 2018, they made 596 cases. So these are the various cases which are made. This another area, this is relevant for all the international scholars to make an emphasis on how the hard law instruments are effectively contributing for various targets of soft law. Okay, so all these are nothing but a covered agreements. This is not mine. All the statistics I took it from WTO.org. Okay, so out of these many covered agreements, you see 464 cases are only from GATT. That is General Agreement on Tariff and Trade. Okay, so I think already I made it all the cases. The last and final one is yes. So therefore, my conclusion, the World Trade Organization is effectively contributing for the purpose in which the United Nations Charter is established. Okay. So therefore, there is no need to. Even people like Donald Trump themselves fearing what is the coerciveness. Okay. Even when we were in the Department of Legal Studies, our professor used to describe. So among us many dispute settlement body, this is the only institution which always will not park. It has a teeth, it will bite and take a flush to whoever is like. Is it of America or China? It's immaterial. Therefore, my submission, the World Trade Organization is effectively working all the purpose in which the United Nations Charter has to work out. So with this, I'll end my session. So thank you very much for the organizers for giving me this opportunity and to share my floor with all the legal luminaries to whom I learned ABCD of international law. Thank you very much.
Nandini.
Thank you, sir, for considering the time restraint and explaining the relationship between WTO and the United Nations and as to how international trade plays an important role in building relationship. Thank you, sir. I welcome Dr. G. Rajashekar, Assistant Professor in the Department of Legal Studies, University of Madras, has a teaching experience of more than a decade. He also served as a research officer in the IPR chair in the Department of Legal Studies, constituted by MHRD, Ministry of Government of India. He holds doctorate degree in law from the Department of Legal Studies, University of Madras, under the guidance of Professor Dr. A. Dravid Ambrose. He has published more than 50 research articles, both in the international moot court competition, including the prestigious Phillips C. Sesshep International Law and Stevens Environmental Law moot court competition. He has drafted problems for moot court competitions, including Henry Dunant International Humanitarian Law Moot Court Competition. Welcome, sir.
Sir, anything? Hello, sir. Sir, sir, yes, sir. Oh, sorry, sir. Oh, sir.
Am I audible? Balaji.
Yes, Professor, you are audible. Good.
Yes. Yes. So, good evening to one and all. So, first of all, I have to, at the outset, I have to thank Professor Chokalingam, sir, for inviting me to be one of the associate of this international celebration commemoration of 75th year of United Nations. Sir, I thank you for this opportunity. Next, I have to thank the Director of Legal Studies for giving me this opportunity. And I have to thank my professor and mentor, Professor Dr. David Ambrose. Only because of him, I was what I am now. And I thank all the organizers for this opportunity. And I have to thank for the enlightened idea on international law by Professor Gandhi sir also. So before I am going to share my thoughts on promotion and protection of human rights, challenges and issues faced by the United Nations organization. So as we all know that the effect of the Second World War taught us a great lesson, resulting in a huge crime for the protection and promotion of the fundamental human rights. So it is an understanding that these type of transnational issues always requires a deep level of cooperation, international cooperation and coordination between the states. So the international community called for a strong international law and norms, and most importantly, they demand effective global institution to develop and deliver
the deliver the coordinated responsibilities. So keeping this in mind, these things in the United Nations was formed as an institution to make effective the in protection of these human rights. As we review the literature clearly shows that the protection and the promotion of human rights is among the most controversial issue at the UN. So because the reason is very simple. In the world, normally states are the central unit. Since states are the central unit, it is an obligation of the state to protect the rights of their citizen. But at the same time, we can see that, or we can understand that, the state itself is the primary violator of the human rights. Nowadays, we can see the incidents of the violation of human rights by individuals also, but predominantly, the states are violating the human rights. When the states are violated the human rights for the rescue of the rights of the citizens, the international community or the attempt made by the international community to intervene in a given country in order to protect the right of the individuals or group are often met with accusation of the interference with the principles of sovereignty and non-intervention. So when the intervention is made, it is the state resist because of its sovereignty and the principles of non-intervention. So, but human rights feature prominently in the, now I am coming to the promotion of the human rights by the United Nations. The Charter of the Human Rights is having series of pledges, and one among them is with respect to the promotion of human rights, promotion and protection of human rights. I quote, to reaffirm faith in the fundamental human rights, in the dignity and worth of the human person, in equal rights of men and women, and of nations, large and small. So, unquote. This strong commitment to the human rights and the dignity of each individual came after the devastating loss of thousands of lives and human abuses during the Second World War. So from these, the role of the United Nations Charter, role of the United Nations has successfully in promoting the human rights. This can be seen from the series of conventions, treaties, declarations adopted since 1945 to give the legal form to the inherent human right. The most significant thus far has been the UDHR adopted by the General Assembly on December 10, 1948. It was the first international attempt to explicitly spell out the basic human rights for all individuals. So we can say that beyond the International Bill of Rights and the core human rights treaties, the General Assembly has adopted over 100 other international treaties and declarations addressing the main or the host issues of such as indigenous people, marriage, slavery, and war crimes. So now we will see some of the varying perspective of this concept of human rights. There has traditionally been, we all know that, the influence of the North and South states in trade as well as in the human rights also. So the most of the Northern state countries, that is exclusively belonging to the Western communities, Western democratic countries, had long stressed the importance of civil and political rights, which deal with the liberty and participation in civil and political life. This is the Northern state. Then coming to the Southern states, Southern dialect states, These are the sometimes referred to the these as we all know that these civil political and civil rights are normally referred as the negative rights. Why we are making it as a negative right means the state should refrain from making any action that would interfere with the individual rights and freedoms. This is the position of these Western countries. Coming to the southern dialect countries, especially the southern global countries, they always move for more social, economic, and cultural rights, which are considered as positive rights, as they require the state or other public authority to take positive steps to ensure access to basics such as food, shelter, education, etc. Since the negative rights came first, they are called as the first generation right, and successively and after that, these positive rights followed this, so it is called as this second generation right, and a third generation right was also there. Later it was emerged, which focuses on collective or group rights rather than individual rights. That is the right to self-determination and the protection of groups of persons such as indigenous people are the examples of this solidarity right. Apart from this, there is a variant, there is another variant has developed in the later part of this 20th century. That is the traditional values, that is the latest variant, has been the emphasis by many countries on the importance of traditional values. So from that we can say from in 2002, UN Human Rights Council adopted a resolution on promoting human rights and fundamental freedoms through a better understanding of traditional values of mankind. So normally these are some of the rights which emanate due to this traditional understanding of this traditional value. So why this concept of traditional values of mankind was developed means many a time these rights are, when these rights are denied, the person who denies this right will justify its action on the basis of what we called as custom and tradition. So that is the practice of child and forced marriages, female genital mutilations, honor killing, and marital rape, and it is also advocated that this it is also somebody advocates that lesbian, gay, bisexual, and transgender LGBT peoples globally who are denied the same right that others in society enjoy. So these are some of the varying perspective reveal that universal understanding of human rights, what we witness in practice is continuous debate and negotiation around how basic rights are defended. So now the certain violations, we all know that despite a robust legal and normative framework surrounding human rights, there are numerous cases of human rights violation around the world each and every day. So the real issue, that is, now so far we have discussed the promotions of the human rights. Now we will come to the protection of human rights. The real issues and challenges faced by the United Nations is when it comes to the part of what we called as the protection. So in the legislative part or in promoting of human rights or in making treaties, declarations, etc., the United Nations has succeeded in its part. But coming to the what we called as this protection part or the enforcement part or the implementation part, it faces certain issues and challenges. As I told you earlier, these two concepts, that is what we called as this concept of sovereignty and another one is the non-intervention principles, often makes a huge challenges to the United Nation when they come in when they come for the what we call come for enforcement or protection of these human rights. So when the UN, when UN tries to investigate alleged abuses, states are often uncooperative and claim interference with the sovereignty, because we are when the sovereignty, that is when a state violates the human fundamental human rights of the citizen, many a time state will not come into the risk of the victims. At that time, if UN tries to make any attempt to protect this concept of this rights of the rights of the human needs, automatically the state will come with this principle, that is that they will not cooperate and they will claim and the interference with sovereignty. So in this regard, once the UN High Commissioner on Human Rights, I quote, monitoring activities and advocacy intended to help better protect the people of a country are refuted as violating the principles of sovereignty or even sometimes with the UN Charter, unquote. Unfortunately, this lack of willingness by many states to cooperate with UN human rights observers is correlated with a large number of violations globally. So despite having a solid reputation for promoting human rights, especially in the area of education, capacity building, and technical assistance, UN has struggled to reconcile its political nature with the principles of protection of human rights. So it is a general feeling this is because of the lack of judicial authority and the enforcement mechanism. There is a limited success on the part of the UN in protecting the human rights. So, as we all know that the subject of human rights is complicated, is a complicated matter. States adapt their, because why we are saying it is a complicated, it becomes more complex means, states adapt their own understanding of human rights and choose to prioritize certain rights over the others. Then, states are party to the same treaties and declaration, gives a false sense of consensus to that treaties. Though they accepted the treaty, and they may be the party to the treaty, but when in coming to the implementation of the treaty, they will not show the consensus, or they will not welcome. But they say they, on the contrary, they take the concept of what we call as the sovereignty as well as the principles of non-intervention in these acts. So although the UN has successfully in placing the concept of universal human rights on the international agenda, actually protecting the human rights still remains as much of a challenge for the UN today as it was in 1945. So how we can come up with the challenges means, until there is an actual consensus among the states, the UN will find it difficult to provide a systematic and authoritative protections. So until otherwise, a common consensus, or until otherwise the state come forward to cooperate with the activities of the United Nations with respect to the protection of human rights, the United Nations will face challenges in implementing in letter and spirit the human rights in letter and spirit. So the actual coordination is required. Until otherwise we reach this coordination, the success of United Nations in protection of human rights in a state will be at stake, and that it has to be a need for further cooperation. So on some time we will say, though sovereignty principles are limited, some others used to say that the sovereignty principles are limited through the responsibility to protect concept and even by the International Criminal Court, yet there are some lacunae of that. That is because of the consensus of the state. Once there is a common consensus arrived between these states, at least for the purpose of protection of the human rights, then the United Nations will complete its goal in protecting the human rights. So with these words, I thank once again the organizers for giving me the opportunity to share my thoughts on challenges and issues with respect to the protection and promotion of human rights. Thank you one and all for the patient hearing. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. G. Rajashekar, sir, for asking everyone to coordinate and explaining the success of UN treaties and declaration in human rights and dignity, which is an alarming need of the hour. I welcome Professor Dr. V. Balaji, sir, presently the director for UG and PG studies in the Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University, Chennai, with 16 years of experience in teaching, research, and administration. He has produced 7 PhD scholars in law and interdisciplinary studies. He was nominated as project director in charge for chair on consumer law and jurisprudence, funded and established by the Ministry of Consumer Affairs, Government of India at the Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University. He has earned several important positions in Tamil Nadu Dr. Ambedkar Law University via Registrar in Charge, Syndicate Member, Controller of Examinations, Director, Department Distance Education, and also authorized a book on Police and Human Rights. He also had been awarded the UGC prestigious research award for teachers. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Am I audible? Thank you.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
At the outset, I take my sincere apologies for making it late because I had the other program, but it was been. I thought this would be completed, so I switched over them, but I got back. I thought that the other speakers can speak and finally, and I got an excuse from principal also. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
And at the outset, I thanked all the organizers and my colleagues and my professors, including Dr. Professor Santosh Kumar, the Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. Chokkalingam sir, Principal, Dr. Gandhi, Dr. David Ambrose, Dr. Gauri Ramesh madam, Dr. Amrindalingam, Dr. Rajashekar, Dr. Balaji, and all others. With this, let me start my speech. Now, I have taken today the issue on Law of Sea. Law of Sea, particularly focusing it on the plastic waste or the plastic issue that has been. Now, in the way the other speakers have been taking the issue, the success or the failure aspect as such, it's very true that the thing has been going on in both the sides in a different way. And my area is now to see that the challenges, what is there for international law, and how they are going to address it. Now, that is the way I am just opening those issues. And the challenges of the law of sea, as you already know, I don't want to go in detail. The 1982, the comprehensive one, what has come around the UNCLOS, and the adaptability of the new law or the changes that have been taking place, and also the subsequently the agreement 11 and of 1994. Now all the things, what? Now the challenges what happened at this point of time is due to the technical advancement in the field of law of sea, and very particularly the marine biodiversity, the ocean acidification, and the plastic pollution. Now this is what I just want to focus a lot about, and the perils of it, and how the international is going to address, even though it is addressing the larger area than this one, but this is a micro level or the macro level that what we can take, and finally how or where are the issues that has been concerning with this plastic issues, where the international can creep in. Now the issue, when I say this plastic pollution or the pollution happening in marine, has brought out very recently, after they found out that the great Pacific garbage patch, which is at the surface area of 1.6 million square kilometers, an area that is the twice the size of Texas or the three times the size of France. Now this patch has taken its eye opener for the entire globe, that what are the catastrophic thing that could happen, because of this, and which has been slowly accumulated years together, and it is not the particular thing that is going to be faded away at this point of time, but it is going to be years together or centuries together as such. So that is what the issue is all about. The another problem is the problem of this kind. It starts from the local level to that of the global level. So that is another stage where international law now has to be focused upon the regional or the sub-regional or the root level, where the national, the other policies of the state, of every state, has to take consideration about this, or it is going to be put it simply, that the marine plastics, just an overall make a statistics about that, 300 million tons of plastic are produced every year for the use of wide variety of applications. At least 8 tons of plastic end up in our oceans every year, and which makes up 80% of all marine debris from surface waters to deep sea sediments. The marine species, which has been worst affected in those cases, ingest and are entangled by the plastic debris, which causes severe injuries and deaths. And plastic pollution also threatens the food safety and quality, the human health, coastal tourism, and contributes toward climate change also. There is an urgent need for this, to explore the use of existing legally binding international agreement to address this marine plastic pollution. Now, the plastic pollution challenges in marine and coastal environments, from local to global governance, where there are two aspects, as rightly the previous speakers have pointed out, the soft law and the hard law. But however, in every case, I can make it as a moral and other rights, the moral or other legal rights. So environmental law is one such thing where the community, the international community, accepts, because of the threat, whatever that has happened anywhere will bring a threat to their own country at a point of time. So that is the reason. See, for example, in the case of human rights, they won't worry about this is a moral right. But this case of environmental issues, whatever happens in one point of the globe will have an impact on the other side of the globe, like what has happened in the depletion of the ozone layer. So that cannot be, the international community cannot close its eyes and to see that whatever that has been happening. But however, the loss is also irreparable loss. Now, once this what that say, the plastics seem to be a daily normal usage of every mankind, for every usage, seems to be a very small thing, but it creates a lot of dangerous thing when it comes to the pollution at marine.
very particularly. That is what we have. I told you about what are the other consequences of that. Now that is a very dangerous thing, or at the global level, that has to be taken care of, or else it will be a irreparable loss in a later point of time where you cannot come back to the original position. Now, for interestingly, in that garbage or in several things, they found out something which are plastics have been there for several years together. What they found out in the patch, the Great Pacific Patch, they found out that there are several centuries old, don't know, the plastic from the invention, that point of time. So it is still surviving. The plastic survives anywhere. The other plastics which are not that much, you know, regular, can be bits and pieces and more doing harm rather than the other solid one. Anyway, the plastic pollution in the marine and the coastal environment is a challenging restoration and the governance issue is concerned. Similar to many environmental problems, marine plastic pollution is a transboundary, and therefore the governance solutions are complex, no doubt. Although the marine environment is unlikely to return to the condition as it was before the plastic era, it is an example of an environmental restoration challenge where successful governance and environmental stewardship would likely result in the healthier global oceanic ecosystem. It has to be argued that a holistic integrated approach that utilizes the scientific expertise, community participation, and other strategies needed to significantly reduce the global plastic pollution problem. Now, the conceptual implications of this, I'll make it very shortly. To date, the local, regional, and international governance has failed to stem the tide of plastic entering the marine environment. The global and local governance responses are needed to effectively manage the plastic marine litter problem. Coordinating state and non-state efforts should be in a holistic, integrated way, which is essential to reducing or mitigating the plastic marine problems. Now, there is a large gap in the international hard law, specifically addressing the land-based marine pollution, UNCLOS, Part 12, now, which is dedicated to the protection and preservation of the marine environment, no doubt. Although, UNCLOS recognizes that there are six different sources of marine pollution, including land-based, but it does not detail about the type of pollutants and the technical rules. That the states are directed to adopt their own laws and regulations addressing the marine pollution and to work with the International Maritime Organization, IMO, in the establishment of rules regarding the ship-sourced pollution. Now, in 1973, the International Convention on Prevention of Pollution from Ship, MARPOL, and 1978 protocol addresses the gaps of the London Dumping Conventions. And Annex 5 of the MARPOL entered in 1988, was revised in 2011, and entered into force in 2013. The annex is particularly important with regard to the marine pollution, as it explicitly prohibits the disposal of plastics anywhere at sea. However, compliance issues or compliance remains an issue, and states are in varying phases of implementing their domestic policies accordingly. Now, the plastic pollution is a global issue, and when it occurs in the areas beyond the national jurisdiction, the issue is responsibility are particularly problematic. A well-known Pacific garbage patch, what I was talking about, is a perfect example. Is one of the five accumulation regions for marine debris. It is located in the east and west parts of Pacific. Finding solution to remove the debris from land or taking responsibility for within the issue of area beyond national jurisdiction from a governance and practical perspective is complex. Market-based solutions have been suggested to clean up this garbage batch. However, the legal parameters on the high seas are limited to UNCLOS. demonstrating the gap in international law when it comes to the mitigation and removal of marine debris from the areas beyond national jurisdiction. Generally speaking, the soft law dominates the global efforts to address marine debris, and which is an essential part of the existing regime, where the United Nations Agenda 21 encourages integrated, precautionary, and anticipatory marine environmental protection. Chapter 17 that sets out the precautionary measures to address marine debris, such as recycling, treatment facilities, and environmental impact assessment. It also outlines the action required for the prevention, reduction, and control ship-sourced pollution. What are the way forward for the governance and marine ecological restoration? Reducing the pollution that litter inputs and impacts on marine ecosystem is the first critical step in the marine environmental restoration. It requires a variety of solutions from the local, regional, national to that of the global scales. With the problem worsening, formal governance through international institution or instrument, regional organizations or government alone cannot resolve the exponentially increasing environmental hazard in this regard. They recognize the limitation of existing international law and are calling for the development of new international instrument specifically addressing the plastic marine pollution. Although this is an important way forward, the process will be complex, may not be supported by all coastal states, and will not come into force anytime soon. Reducing the marine plastic pollution nationally can occur through the integrated policy approaches. And the integrated policy approaches provide a holistic approach to manage the problem where government, which I mean national, state, provincial, and local, NGOs, the key industries, and communities can work together. Because marine debris is a complex, pressing issue, an integrated approach would more likely be supported by political actors and the wider community. Now, there are several aspects to it where the consumers, as individual citizens, are also, you know, has to be enlightened about the use of plastics, and many countries have taken steps, no doubt, even India, but it's not enough. We have to completely transform that, where the nature, before the nature strikes back. And as I pointed out earlier, that we need some sort of immediate response from the international community to address this problem specifically, where there is a stern ban should be there, to see that the environment is protected, the marine, which is the sea. Why we are all, we know that the law of sea is a common heritage of mankind, but of course at the same time, we have to save it and preserve it for the future generations also, or else the loss is irreparable and we cannot able to make the things right. Now with this, I conclude my speech, and I thank every organizers for giving me this wonderful opportunity, and also to meet all my and everybody. Thank you, Ananda.
Thank you, sir. So there are no questions from the participants. So I ask Sharanya, you can take forum.
The valuable workshop has almost come to an end. It could not have happened without the collective effort of the team and the participants. Hence, we kindly request our beloved Professor Dr. Anita Fabiola, ma'am, to deliver the oath of thanks.
Good evening, one and all. It is my privilege. Can you hear me, sir? Sir, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am. We are hearing.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, one and all. It is my privilege to be asked to propose a vote of thanks on this virtual workshop on success of United Nations and its future challenges. First of all, on the outset, I thank the Almighty for giving this opportunity to one and all. I thank our beloved Director of Legal Studies, Professor Dr. N.S. Santosh Kumar, for always his appreciation for us and helping us to make this workshop a success. Thank you, sir, for giving us this opportunity. And I, at the outset, I thank our chief guest, most distinguished Dr. M. Koteshwara Rao, Indian Society of International Law, for giving a brief outline on UN success, its objectives, and its challenges. Thank you, sir. And I take this opportunity to thank, a sincere thanks for giving an excellent coverage on the success. On the success of United Nations and its challenges, how the governing and all by Dr. Gandhi Dean. VIT School of Law, VIT Chennai. And my sincere thanks to my beloved professor, Dr. A. David Ambrose, former head Department of Legal Studies, for giving a brainstorming session on speaking about United Nations multilateral approach within the framework of United Nations. Further, I render my sincere thanks to Associate Professor Dr. S. Amitalingam, Tamil Nadu National Law University, Tiruchirappalli, for speaking about the programs of United Nations and WTO. There's the interlinks between GATT, WTO, and thank you, sir. And I render my heartfelt thanks to Dr. G. Rajashekar, Assistant Professor, Department of Legal Studies, University of Madras, for speaking about United Nations and human rights, how it's helps in promoting human rights. Further, I render my sincere thanks to Professor Dr. V. Balaji, Head of Department of International Law, Tamil Nadu, Dr. Ahmed Law University, for speaking about marine pollution and how it can be combated in the future. Thank you, sir. I thanks one. Further, I give my sincere thanks to our beloved principal. When we have thought of conducting a workshop, immediately said, let's do it. Thanks, sir. Thanking for making this platform and helping eminent scholars to speak about and discuss international law. Thank you very much, Professor. Dr. Chokalingam, sir. Thank you, sir. And I thank all my colleagues, especially Balaji, Dr. Balaji, for making all the technical issues, taking care of all the technical issues, and students who were there to compare Saranya, third year, and Nandini, second year, and all who have been here to help us. Further, I thank all the government college principals who came here and encouraged us and participated in this workshop. And I thank every participant in this workshop who made this workshop a grand success. Thank you, one and all. Thank you.
My national anthem.
The feedback link is posted in the chat box. Request the participants to kindly follow it. We conclude the event with the national anthem for the day. Standing united despite all hurdles, request everyone to stand now.
Janagana mana adhinayaka jaya hind bharata bhagya vidhata Punjab sindh gujarat maratha dravida kunkada vanga Vindhya himachala yamuna ganga Ujjala jaladhi taranga Nava shubha naam में जागे तव शुभ आशीष मांगे गाहे तव जयकार।